Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Big Daddy Top Hat here. This week, I decided to rack my brains and consider what is probably the biggest name beat-em-up I am yet to feature on here. Then within minutes it hit me. That title has to be River City Ransom, one of the most popular games in the genre available on the 8-bit NES. This game, known as Street Gangs here in Europe, is amongst the most memorable titles of the late 80s. The non-linear beat-em-up with RPG elements is unforgettable in both its gameplay and presentation, even offering two-player cooperative functionality, a rarity on 8-bit platforms. Whilst this is a game that many people had a lot of fun with, I doubt many people are aware of just how confusing the history and genealogy of this game actually is. River City Ransom is part of a very chronologically contrived series of games, or even a series of games, if that makes any sense yet. Regardless of this, we are going to break the franchise down and make sense of it all today, and further analyse the quality and uniqueness this quirky game brings to the table. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the mad story of River City Ransom and its confusing history. Yeah. To understand the history of River City Ransom, we first have to go back to a man we have mentioned on this channel many times before, Yoshihisa Kishimoto. In 1986, on behalf of Technos Japan, he would release a revolutionary game known as Niketsu Koha Kunio-kun, a title that roughly translates to Hot-Blooded Tough Guy Kunio. Kunio is the game's star character, who features in the game as a high school delinquent who must stand up against a series of rival gangs frequently targeting his classmate, Hiroshi. It is said that Kishimoto based the character on himself from his own high school years. The game was innovative in that it offered gameplay whereby the player could travel either right or left, but also move towards or away from the background by pressing up or down. A gameplay function that Technos had applied previously with their wrestling game Mapmania. Hot-Blooded Tough Guy Kunio established many beat-em-up genre tropes. However, the playing field was limited to a series of three screen-wide areas and features no continuous scrolling, so there was still some way to go. As awesome as this little game was for Technos, to find success internationally with the game, they made the decision to give it an entire graphical overhaul to make it more appealing to Western markets. The altered version of the game, known as Renegade, featured a graphical style based off of the movie The Warriors, and subsequently became a smash hit across the globe. So, thus far we have one game with two different skins, but going forward things got a little more crazy. Kishimoto was proud of his game, but knew he was capable of creating something even more impressive. So just 1 year after Kunio's first adventure, Mr. Kishimoto would release the game's spiritual sequel, Double Dragon, a title that featured long scrolling stages, but more importantly, two-player cooperative action, pretty much setting the mould for the future of the entire genre. So now we have one game featuring two skins, but also a spiritual sequel, Double Dragon. Interestingly, going forward, there would not only be countless future beat-em-ups that would hold the Double Dragon brand, but both Kunio-kun and Renegade would both receive entirely different sequels too. In terms of Renegade games, future games would be developed in Europe, with Target Renegade being released in 1988. To make matters more confusing, there are multiple different games that share this name. The NES version of the title is a completely different game to the one that can be found on home computer formats, with the version of the game found on 8-bit micros delivering a superior experience. In fact, the computer versions of Target Renegade are often considered classics in Europe, and the game is still celebrated somewhat to this day as a result. With Target Renegade's success, home computers would also receive Renegade 3. The game, developed by Imagine Software, had the subtitle of The Final Chapter, which was a rare occasion where the marketing was telling the truth, as this was the last game to carry the Renegade name. This brings us back to the original Japanese version of Niketsu Koha Kunio-kun, and the future of the Kunio-kun brand. You would think that the next game would be another beat-em-up featuring our hero Kunio, but the reality could not be further from what Japanese consumers would actually get. The follow-up game to the first Kunio-kun was known as Niketsu Koko Dodgeball Boo, a bloody dodgeball game developed by a man at Technos known as Hiroshi Sato. Kishimoto's Kunio character would be shoehorned into the game due to the character's popularity. The Japanese version features an opening sequence which parodies the pre-stage introductions from Kunio-kun, which depicts Kunio being struck by a dodgeball thrown by a passing thug, and his teammates chase after said thug. Amusingly, and to make matters even more confusing, this game saw a release in the West too, but like the original Kunio-kun game, the Western version would see vast changes and all connections to the Kunio character were removed. In Super Dodgeball, the Japanese teams of Neketsu High School and Hanazono High School were changed to the American teams of Dallas and Chicago. The characters' skin tones and hair colours were also changed accordingly in the Western version to reflect this. The game would prove popular enough in Japan that there would be even more Kunio Dodgeball games made in the future, along with other sports titles too, such as one of my personal favourites, Neketsu High School Dodgeball Club Soccer, which I played through and loved in my childhood under the Western name of Nintendo World Cup. After the original Neketsu Koha Kunio-kun, then Neketsu Koko Dodgeball Boo, we finally got another beat-em-up, known as Downtown Neketsu Monogatari, a game known in Europe as Street Gangs and in North America as River City Ransom. Like with all previous games released in the Kunio series, the Japanese and Western versions would vary greatly. Downtown Neketsu would be a game that featured a story where Kunio teams up with his rival from the original game, Ricky, as they fight alongside each other in two-player cooperative action to take on students from other high schools. In fact, the Japanese version of this game would also introduce a number of characters who would go on to appear in subsequent Kunio games too. When it comes to the Western release, River City Ransom, aka Street Gangs, the Japanese game would undergo great changes in both storyline and graphical presentation. Once again, as pretty much is standard with these Technos games by now, this was all simply to try and make the experience more palatable for a Western market. In fact, when it comes to this ambitious localization, River City Ransom was actually published by American Technos, a new North American subsidiary of Technos Japan. Like with the creation of Renegade before it, River City Ransom was no simple overhaul, and in addition to the obvious things such as anglicising characters and location names, and the game's in-game dialogue, character sprites would also be completely redrawn for the game, replacing Japanese high school uniforms with t-shirts and jeans. The easiest difficulty setting was also removed from the game, a practice that seems to have been quite common with Western releases at the time, which appears to have been to prevent the likelihood of gamers hiring titles from Blockbuster and completing them in one evening. Streets of Rage 3, for example, would receive this exact same treatment. Video game rentals were illegal in Japan due to strict copyright laws, thus meaning Technos had less to worry about when it came to the game's difficulty over there. In fact, they got a little bit cheeky with this practice, as they would also choose to remove the ability to disable player against player damage. So, there were more opportunities to lose in a Western playthrough too, other than just the difficulty spike. Amusingly, years later, another localization of this same game would be released for the PS4 and Nintendo Switch, as part of the Kunio-kun Retro Brawler bundle. This version of the game would be named Downtown Neketsu Story, and would be a game released in English that retains the story and graphics of the Japanese original. Today though, we are focused on the most well-known iteration of the game, River City Ransom, which features a new plot of two high school students, known as Alex and Ryan, as they make their way through River City in an attempt to rescue Ryan's girlfriend, Cindy. Cindy is being held captive by a villain named Slick, so the boys must battle through various gangs and their leaders to make progress. No matter which version of this classic you happen to play, they all share the same beat-em-up gameplay with action role-playing elements. Whilst the two-player cooperative combat in the game is similar to that of Double Dragon, the game differs in that the action in this game is actually non-linear, and instead players must explore an open world in a sandbox manner. In terms of combat, players can perform the typical punch, kicks and jumps, as well as use foreign objects such as brass knuckles, steel pipes and dustbins to gain the competitive advantage. These can all be swung wildly or even thrown at enemies. On top of this, players and enemies can also dash, and paired with great enemy AI and an ability to block, lead to some fantastic beat-em-up fun, especially when we consider how rudimentary the NES hardware is too. In terms of role-playing game elements, coins can be gathered upon defeating enemies, and these funds can be used on special books that can be purchased from the shops found amongst the game's streets. These books can be used to power up your characters in order to improve their effectiveness in combat. Once a book is in the player's inventory, the book can then be read to learn new knowledge to be able to perform new fighting techniques. In-game funds can additionally be spent on food items, or even spa treatment, which can be used to replenish health, and more importantly, to further increase players' stats. The ability to level up the stats of your playable characters is almost essential when it comes to making progress in the game, as like in many classic RPGs of old, if you wander into the wrong area before being strong enough, then it can be quite easy to get killed. So sometimes grinding for power-ups is basically essential in a playthrough. Speaking of wandering into the wrong neighbourhood, in this sandbox-like world we have various gangs with stupid names, such as the generic dudes, the frat guys, the jocks, or the squids. These gangs control different areas, and the text at the bottom of the screen will let you know who you are up against as you walk from screen to screen into their territories. The game also features shopping areas where no gangs are present, instead allowing the player to simply focus on retail therapy, rather than a bit of fisticuffs for a change. Across the game, the title features a grand total of 9 different gangs, who can be distinguished from one another via their clothing. Each gang has their own unique characteristics and varying attack patterns. One of the many charms of this game that you will notice when in combat with these foes is the large over-the-top facial expressions they show throughout fights. The oversized heads and cartoony graphics in the game were a fantastic choice considering the NES's 8-bit limitations. Like many Technos games, you will notice that the title features a high-quality soundtrack with plenty of memorable tunes. In fact, speaking of memorable melodies, the theme tune from Double Dragon is even amongst the game's soundtrack, further connecting this confusing series of Technos games together. In terms of the goal of the game, in this openish world experience, players must defeat 4 bosses in order to gain access to River City High, where Cindy is being held. Along the adventure, you will also notice that everyone in this game has something to say, even if it is simply just barf when you manage to down opponents. Occasionally though, people can reveal useful information, for example the existence of hidden rooms. At the beginning of the video, we already mentioned who Alex, Ryan and Cindy all are, but another recurring character we have yet to touch on is Roxy. Roxy is the villain of the game Slick's girlfriend, who in the game has a change of heart and decides to reveal where Cindy is being held, and gives out other information that can be used along the way. Once finally inside the high school, players take on a number of bosses, including twin brothers Randy and Andy, which is the part of the game that includes the fantastic usage of the Double Dragon theme. The final encounter of the game takes place against Slick, on the high school's roof, who upon defeating finally brings this novel game to a close. Upon completion of the game informs the players that gang members went on to become honor students, and Cindy found time to finish her shopping that day, before the credits roll. When it comes to the reception that this game would receive back in the day, in Japan, Famitsu would give the original version of the game a positive review, commenting that they liked that the game mixed up fighting with skillfully incorporated RPG elements. The French magazine Player One would also look at Street Gangs, who would also love the title, giving it a score of 93%. The game never particularly sold well outside of Japan, even though Technos went to the effort of reskinning the game for a Western audience. However, over the years, the game has become more and more popular, becoming somewhat of a cult classic. Retrospective reviews have been very positive. IGN said the fighting mechanics are exceptionally achieved, and the RPG-esque elements give it a ton of depth and replayability, concluding that it is a classic cult-followed NES brawler that still is deep and engaging as it was in the 8-bit era. Whilst the NES version of the game is the most remembered today, there were other versions of the game too. The following year of 1990 would see Downtown Neketsu ported to the Sharp X68000, the powerful Japanese computer that was perfect for gaming. This version of the game received various enhancements, which made this conversion even more impressive than the NES original. Changes would even include new fighting techniques players could use, and even new locations and bosses. The game even now had a save feature. The game would arrive on the PC Engine Super CD-ROM in 1993 too, featuring enhanced graphics, an arranged Redbook soundtrack, and fully voiced characters. The player's progress is saved in this version on the PC Engine's backup memory, but the rest of the game is almost identical to the Famicom version. River City Ransom EX would make it to the Game Boy Advance in 2004, but of course I'm going to save talking about this one for a future episode of Handhelds Around the World. the gaming show I produce whenever I'm on the move. Now, when it comes to River City Ransom's place in history, there will be all sorts of Kunio games made down the line, and the franchise gets even more chronologically confusing when we consider that Technos would eventually go out of business. But we are still receiving new Kunio games even now. As recently as 2019, Arc System Works would publish a spin-off known as River City Girls, which I actually have a lot to say about in the future. But there are all sorts of other Kunio-kun games that I'd like to talk about too. Let me know in the comment section down below which games in the series you would be most keen for me to look at in depth next. And if you are new here, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell to see weekly content like this in your feed. When it comes to Technos, I am slowly covering every Double Dragon game that has ever been released, so you may want to check out my brand new Double Dragon playlist after you have finished watching this video. Special thank yous go out to my channel's patrons who make working full-time on YouTube that little bit easier. So additional thank yous go out to Sebastian Velez, Carl Johnson, A Murder of Crows, Heyo Paulo Lopez, Joseph Razmek, Luke Samuel Denton, Corey Ironmarsh Sr., Capcom vs. SNK, BXL Gotham, Rowan Dinched, Evan Balder, Philip Nampf, Cambo Rambo 82, Azrael Rorikai, Keith Ferguson, Dropkin Varela, Prince Knight, Michael Cullix, Ego, Jordan Durant, TOG Driver, Angel Light 85, Alephia Swanson, Timothy W. Haskins II, Nick Daniels, Princess Zana, Glennie Glenn, Daniel Daly, Computer Man, House of Ted, SpongeMap B, Gary Pinkett, ECU Professor, Justin Wang, Aaron McNamara, Instant Gratification Monkey, Man Shovel, James Bishop, JB, Posty XL, Michael Hall, Wesley Sanghee, Ben Slightly, Langston Miller, Noob, Brian Barry, Stephen Lewis, Sarah Powell, Flaming Renee, Marvin Araliga, Chris Cool, Adrian Hannington, Bernard NG, Richard Stu Stewart, James McDonald, Crazy Yarl, Dan Van Dammit, Adam Castin, Louis Fiant, John Bates, David Bell, Chris Fisk, Paul Elliott, Mean Machine Dean, Mike Bruno, Rick67, Antonio Rodriguez, Hans Christian, Craig Jenkins, Tom Elliott, Retroverse.com, Casey Wright, Synth Spaces, Zai, Andrew Bazansky, Gunther Hendricks, and all the other fine people who have chosen to back me on the Patreon platform. Thank you so much for making my job just that little bit easier. Yeah, cheerio!